telling me that you have a way to defer the tax situation there? Is that what you're telling me?
Yes, absolutely, yes. And so the first one I was referring to is a 1031 exchange, which only applies to investment real estate. The second one I'm referring to is called a deferred sales trust. It works for primary homes. It works for investment real estate. It works for highly appreciated public stock. It works for private stock. It works for collectibles, artwork. It works for Bitcoin, cryptocurrency. And it's literally, I think, the best kept secret. And not only that is it's new to people, but it has a track record of thousands of closes now, right? At over 25 years, 15 times, no change IRS.
My mind was blown and it's too good to be true. It's too good to be true. My CPA would have told me about it. My commercial broker would have told me about it. No, we didn't know about it at Marcus & Millichap until 10 years ago, and now we know it.
But I'll tell you, you made me a believer when we got the wire from our mutual client who made this work. And it was a real eye opener to see that there are ways that people can use the regulatory framework, if properly structured, to invest 1031 exchange dollars in things that you would not think were like kind to what they exited from. So it was very impressive. I got to say, you are the first one I've seen pull this off, and I'm pretty hesitant to believe in a lot of these kinds of things. So it's a major feat for me to say, wow, this actually really worked. And it was really cool.
So using the deferred sales trust allowed them to hold on to those assets. I mean, obviously they're, you know, the legal structures around them, they're not in their names, but now that chunk of money is a cow in their farm, a really nice cow that does some really amazing things tax-wise and allows them to get the income that they need in order to meet their expenses. It's going to extend the length of time that they're going to have income by a pretty wide margin.
1031 is a way to shelter your income when you sell the thing. The DST is a way to avoid the 1031 and not have to suffer the time penalty and free up your hand to negotiate at whatever time you figure is appropriate. And it allows you to sit on the sideline, or it allows you to accelerate when needed and accumulate your capital.
So I found you, just so your listeners know, on a podcast, and I'm like, wow, this guy has really leaned in. He's articulate. He's very smart. When I worked in 1031 exchanges, we didn't really talk much about DSTs. We just used them to sort of round out a 1031 exchange. And I never knew that it could be the only solution that you need for a primary resident to take, you know, their capital gains and defer it and put it into another property. That was like mind blowing for me to understand that concept, which I learned on the podcast that you were on.
Over our career and during different tax periods, we've seen, you know, these tax avoidance, tax minimization, offshore, all these different strategies undertaken to minimize or avoid taxes. And then I can tell you that, you know, some of them are just not worth the trouble. And so I was skeptical. Admittedly, I was skeptical. I thought, oh yeah, here we go. Another one of these, right? And then they say, no, it really is different, right? So look more closely. We looked more closely. We had, I honestly, 2 years of conversations. 2 years. Now we were being due diligence at the same time that we were doing due diligence, but 2 years is a long time to be, you know, sort of flirting with the idea of and getting to know the people and getting to really understand the transaction. Yeah, long story short, you know, we got comfortable, although we are not tax attorneys, lawyers, or estate planning attorneys, that at least, you know, from an investment perspective, that, you know, it made sense to sell in a highly appreciated asset, get liquid, hold that in this type of a deferred or installment sale type of instrument, and then just be in a position then to do the most important thing. I'm probably stealing your next question, which is time. They say, well, you can't make more time. You can. The deferred sales trust, in a way, allows you to lengthen the investment time horizon for those assets after getting liquid, but before having to feel the tax impact. And from an investment manager's perspective, time horizon is the most important element in investing.
Yeah, so I'd say be early and connect with us and just clarify your vision for what you want your wealth plan to be. And that's just not just your wealth, but that's your time and your energy. That's where do you think the market's at? Like, do you think it's a buyer's market, right? Do you think it's a good time to buy? Do you think it's a good time to be in debt? And if so, just keep buying real estate right now. But if you think it's not, and perhaps you want to wait on the sidelines and have some liquidity, get out of debt and wait for what we call a deal to hit you over the head, then that's why you would use the deferred sales trust, regardless if you're a baby boomer or if you're a professional. But essentially, if you connect with us, we're going to help you map out a wealth plan. And as part of that wealth plan, we're going to write a line down the middle of a piece of page. And we're going to say, continue as you are with a 1031 exchange, or continue as you are with a deferred sales trust, or a mixture of both. And we're looking at all of the pros and cons side by side, and then let you decide what's best for you. We are live with our first cryptocurrency mastermind. Hey, welcome everybody. My name is Brett Swartz. Hold on a second. Let me make sure I turn off the background noise there. All right, now I'm back. Okay, sorry about that, guys. I'm so excited for you guys to be here, guys and gals. And my name is Brett Swartz. I'm the founder of Capital Gains Tax Solutions. And so we believe most high net worth individuals and those who help them, they struggle with clarifying capital gains tax deferral options, especially when it comes to the sale of highly appreciated public stock, private stock, cryptocurrency, investment, real estate. And so we're on a mission to help you if you're selling cryptocurrency or other highly appreciated assets, or if you're a real estate professional who's wanting to help your clients defer capital gains taxes and move into a world where you can have cash flow, you can have some depreciation, you can have some diversification. And so we're going to go on a journey together. We're going to do a little bit of a presentation, but we're also going to invite your feedback, okay, and your expertise, especially for those who are in the cryptocurrency world. We are tax experts, and we're also commercial real estate experts. And also my good friend here, Jake Miller, is a financial advising expert. But together, we want to try to bring both communities together, the community of the cryptocurrency world, the commercial real estate investment real estate world, and the financial advising world, to help you and or help your clients defer capital gains taxes and create what's called transformational exit planning. That being said, Jake, you want to introduce yourself? He's my co-host. He's going to be along on this journey for us. Jake, give a little bit about your background and your focus.
Wonderful. Well, let me just tell you my story as briefly as I can. I started out in wealth management for high net worth individuals and found out quickly that oftentimes a lot of the client's advisors, whether it be the attorney, the CPA, the insurance person, any number of, you know, executive team like advisors, oftentimes we're pulling clients in different directions. What Brett and I have done here is we help bring all the advisors together in one place. I have a series of professional service businesses, from a tax practice to a wealth management firm to a national insurance agency, as well as property management. And with all of that together, with my experience of helping clients through one of my firms, which is a consulting business called Strategic Tax Solutions, we've been able to partner with Brett as a trustee with a deferred sales trust strategy that allows us to essentially help clients with crypto and help clients in a number of different capital gains situations to essentially keep those dollars working for them. What they would otherwise, we have a client with around $20 million in crypto, and instead of paying half of that to the government in taxes right now, being fully transparent and clear with the government, we're able to show them those transactions and retain those funds in this structure that we have, so that they can continue to make that money work for them going forward.
Amazing, Jake. So we're going to dive right in. I'm going to share my screen. We're going to go through a little bit of a presentation for 30 minutes, and then we're going to open it up for questions and or try to do some breakout rooms so people can start to meet one another. So give me 1 second as I pull this up in my Google Share file.
Very good. And just as a few housekeeping items, there'll be moments when we mute the whole audience. There'll be moments where we encourage that you speak and interact. And we want to make this a weekly item. Feel free to provide your comments and suggestions so that we can better serve you ongoing with education and relevant facts.
Perfect. Yep. And so Jake, can you see my screen okay?
Yep.
Okay, excellent. And I'm going to maximize this as well. And here we go. So this is the one secret to overcoming what's called, we call the biggest objection to the deferred sales trust. And we really want to teach you right now as much as we can the best kept secret, we believe, to sell commercial real estate, to sell cryptocurrency, to sell primary homes, and then to invest back into real estate or securities, all tax deferred, okay? So I am the founder of Capital Gains Tax Solutions. Legal disclaimer real quick before we start here. Jake nor I are tax professionals, meaning we're not CPAs, we're not tax attorneys. And we also strongly encourage you to bring your trusted advisors to this mastermind, to a one-on-one consultation with us and seek independent advice here to make sure that you guys are feeling great with your professionals behind you, okay? But what are some of the facts that are going on? Let's start with the big picture. So according to the American Bankers Association, they did a big study, and this study found that about $17 to $20 trillion will pass from one generation to the next in the next 20 years. And this is known as the largest wealth transfer in the history of the planet. So this is by the baby boomers. They also found that same study, there's about 77 million baby boomers in the US alone, and every single day about 10,000 of them are turning 65. So you have this huge amount of wealth, and this wealth is, by the way, is tied into high-end primary homes, businesses, now cryptocurrency, maybe not so much for the baby boomer generation for the cryptocurrency, but some of them certainly do. And they're struggling with this huge tax. And this tax is somewhere between 30 and 50% in capital gains tax and depreciation recapture, depending on the asset. And so what are they to do? Well, they're not sure. In fact, they feel trapped. And most people before they meet us, they feel trapped. And they feel trapped by this capital gains tax. And they, you know, oftentimes won't sell. In fact, that's where this kind of story starts with this cryptocurrency mastermind. Is we have met clients over the years, and unfortunately, after the 2017 crypto crash, we found folks that wish they would have found us, but they couldn't find us. The same thing goes for real estate, okay? And I want I'm going to speak to some of the business professionals here right now. I want you to know that it's okay to dream of helping your clients to defer millions in capital gains tax and becoming the number one in your profession. I also want you to know that it's okay to dream about unlocking new deals for clients, new exit plans, new cash flow streams, right? And becoming and being in the business of solving your clients' problems. You know, we believe, Jake and I, we're actually not in the capital gains tax deferral world. We're not in the real estate world. We're not in the financial advising world. We're actually in the world of solving problems. And we use certain tools to do that in our particular niche focus. But that's where we want to make you focus, or help you to focus even, or remind you to focus on, you're actually in the business of solving clients' problems. So before we get too far into this, who is this presentation for? Well, it's for anyone who has or a client, or if you are yourself or the principal considering selling cryptocurrency or other highly appreciated asset. It could be business, it could be a primary home, it could be stock, it could be artwork, collectibles, it could be a horse. By the way, did you know you could deferred sales trust a horse, Jake? I don't know if you knew that or not, but you can. You can deferred sales trust just about anything that's highly appreciated. Here's the thing though, it has to be at least $1 million net worth. So, and it is to have at least $1 million of gain. So net of all debt. So after closing costs, everything, those are our parameters. If it's too small, then we do not transact. It's too small. So what is a deferred sales trust? Let's first of all clarify what it is. It's just an installment sale. For those who don't know what an installment sale is, it's essentially you can become the lender, right? You can become the bank, and you can carry back paper. Paper means you're becoming instead of taking all of the cash, you're saying, you know what, how about you owe me that cash over a period of time and I'll slowly receive that. Well, the government allows us to defer tax when we do that. It's called an installment sale. So the deferred sales trust is just an installment sale. And why would you need one? Well, the first reason is you want to defer some tax. The second reason could be you want to sell something that's highly appreciated. The next reason might be you might want to, you know, get some cash flow and invest those funds into maybe something that's a little bit more conservative, something that gives you some timing to go back into different investments, and also give you some diversification. And I want you to think about Blockbuster versus Netflix. And Blockbuster is just sort of the old ways of doing things. And it's really transactional exit planning, which means essentially you either sell and pay the tax, or you sell and you have to give up a number of things which you don't want to give up, such as liquidity, diversification, the ability to buy real estate, the ability to buy a business, the ability to sit on the sidelines and wait tax deferred. Well, that is what the deferred sales trust gives you, which is why it's like the Netflix, okay? So here we go. As a quick background for me as well, for those who are curious, I started out my career at a company called Marcus & Millichap. I was a commercial real estate agent, and I focused on multifamily brokerage. I grew up in the business and loved investment real estate, and found that I wanted that to be my profession. So I started out, I learned from some of the best in the business. For those who don't know who Marcus & Millichap, they're kind of like the Navy SEALs for investment brokerage. And so I learned a ton, and I have done lots of business over the years, including I also own properties, I broker properties, and I've closed 1031 exchanges, Delaware Statutory Trust, of course, Deferred Sales Trust. And at one point, I held my Series 22 and 63 licenses. I've been featured on a bunch of media. You can look that up. One of my favorite ones is this guy named Kevin Harrington. I was on their podcast with Seth Green, and they do, they're the guys from, Kevin is the guy from Shark Tank. So it's pretty cool. But it wasn't always that way. In fact, in 2006, I was at Marcus & Millichap, and I'm trying to learn the business, and I was not Leonardo DiCaprio, you know, with my fist pumped on a cold call closing deals. In fact, I was one of the guys in the background, like looking like, you know, bewildered, scratching my head, like, how in the world are these guys making all this money? My cousin was making a bunch of money, and he was my mentor. He believed in me, and he spoke life into me, and he encouraged me to keep growing. And so 2006 was there. I'm working at Marcus & Millichap. I'm newly married after another year, two, and all of a sudden the marketplace, guess what? It falls apart. So I go from making a little bit of money to next to nothing overnight. I don't know if you've ever been in a position where you feel scared and you're frustrated. And that's where I was. I found myself kind of in disbelief that I was not succeeding. And it was really frustrating. But worse than that, I was now with my wife and my baby, and we were trying to, you know, keep food on the table. So I did what every good, I think, entrepreneur or real estate wannabe does. You go get a side job and a side hustle. And so that's what I did. By day, I would make cold calls. And by night, I would serve cheesecake at Cheesecake Factory as a server. And so I remember walking into the Cheesecake Factory, and the gentleman who's my manager, who's actually in this picture right here, and him saying, "Hey, Brett, if I hire you, are you going to just retire in a couple months when you close a deal from the Cheesecake? I don't want to put all this money into it." I said, "You know what? I will not. I promise you, I will stay for at least 2 years. If that's what you want." And he says, "Yes, I want at least 2 years." And so that's what I did. And so by day, I would make cold calls, try to help grow my business. And by night, I'd keep the lights on at Cheesecake Factory. But while I was going through this financial struggle, so were my clients. You see, they had overpaid for property in 05 and 06. They had done a thing called a 1031 exchange. That's just another way to defer tax on something, trade it property. And then they, unfortunately, the market crashed. So some of them lost half, some of them lost all. But what we learned during that transition was you want to sell high and buy low. You don't want to get caught and not being able to sell. And this goes back to why we're here today, which is folks that are in the position to potentially sell high and not go through the 2007 crash again, and be able to take some of the wealth off of the table for the cryptocurrency and be able to defer that and invest it in different things. And so this is what I learned through the real estate crash. And I want to teach you here right now. And so after, by the way, this is 11 years in the making here. My wife and I have 5 kids. We live here in Sacramento, California. Our firm is national. We help folks from all 50 states and really execute on this deferred sales trust. And then we have strategic alliances like Jake to help manage the funds and work as a team to execute this. So I discovered the 10 years, the hard way to do this. And I really just want to know how many of you want to learn the easy way. And by the way, if you've been struggling, this is probably why. The perfect storm, which we've talked about a little bit about the baby boomers and all the wealth, but I believe it's also the perfect storm and opportunity for cryptocurrency to be all-time highs and potentially higher too, but chance to get some of that capital off of the table and get a little more diversified, a little more liquidity, and then go buy real estate whenever you want to. By the way, if you don't know about this and you've been struggling with selling your cryptocurrency or other assets and the capital gains tax, it's okay. It's not your fault. Your CPA doesn't know about it either. or they might know, or they might think they know, but until they come and sign the NDAs and look at our track record and get really comfortable with who we are and all the folks that we have in place, and I'm going to share a couple deal stories to give you some of that confidence here in a minute. Then once they know, a lot of them join us after they learn about what we do, then you can really feel confident about this, okay? And then if you try 1031 exchanges, by the way, that does not work for cryptocurrency, just in case you're wondering, but the deferred sales trust does. So I'm going to fast forward a little bit and tell you a couple of deal stories. So this is a client of mine, and I always like to use actual deals, who sold a multifamily property for $1.7 million. I'm also a multifamily broker here in Sacramento, and so I helped him to sell this. He had about $500,000 of debt, and he had about $350,000 of taxes to defer. Well, see, for him, he wanted to sell at the all-time high. He felt like it was really the height of the market. He wanted to pay off some debt. He wanted to defer some tax. But he was very skeptical about this structure and this tax strategy. See, he grew up in a real estate family, used to doing 1031 exchanges, very used to what he was comfortable with. And so he had to really, really shift his trust. And he was very skeptical, and he tells his whole story. But this is Steve Prince. He's out of Sacramento. Here's another deal we just did for a client out of Colorado. It was they're worth about $25 million, and they sold this apartment complex for about $5 million, and they deferred about $2 million of tax. Here's another one in near Santa Cruz, sold for about $8 million, and they deferred about $2.6 million of tax. Another one in Palo Alto for a primary home. So the list goes on and on and on. And so what we found over all of these deals that we've helped so many people do is all of a sudden we got just a huge flux in the last 60 days of cryptocurrency folks who also want to sell. And this is the number one objection, right? This deferred sales trust sounds amazing, but I need my trusted advisor to say yes before I move forward. I don't understand how my CPA doesn't know about this. And so I just want to tell you a couple deal stories from really just two to help you just really feel and gain instant credibility, and also show you how to tell that, even if you have no DST or tax deferral experience. By the way, we're not asking you to be CPAs or tax attorneys. We're just simply asking you to consider sharing some stories with your clients. So first of all, why are people going crazy about the deferred sales trust? Well, first of all, Biden is proposing a call for an elimination of the 1031 exchange, as well as a potential doubling of the federal capital gains tax rate from 20 to about 40. On top of that, you have cryptocurrency, Bitcoin. This picture is a little bit old, hit 56,000, and this is kind of all over the place right now with prices. Cryptocurrency is going through the roof, and a lot of prices are just so highly appreciated, and folks are faced with a big, big amount of tax. So let's dive in right into the number one way to overcome and make you feel really comfortable. So in the first promo video, you saw this gentleman named David Young, and he gave a little bit of his story. He talked about two years that he was reviewing the deferred sales trust with his legal team. What we didn't talk about is just who this David Young is. Well, David Young worked with a gentleman named Bill Gross. And Bill Gross is one of the most respected financial advisors. For those who are not in the financial advising world, it's kind of like the Warren Buffett of the financial advising world. Very respected and very well known, very credible. Well, David Young was like his right-hand guy. And for about over about 10 years, they worked together at a company called PIMCO. PIMCO is a very respected group as well. And they took it from about $80 billion to $1.2 trillion, and David rose to become an executive VP at PIMCO. Well, about 15 years ago, he retired from that, and he formed a group called Anfield Capital out of Southern California. And with that, he was able to look at the deferred sales trust. And like he said in the video, he goes, you know what? I get approached with a lot of stuff from a lot of people, and I'm very, very just cautious to ever really look at a lot of these things, or even if I look at them, I say no. Well, he was open-minded, and he took a two-year due diligence period. And after 2 years, he decided to not only say yes to the deferred sales trust, but he also said he's going to be a part of the new asset allocation advisory team. And so David manages money for some of the largest endowments, sovereign wealth, and pension funds in the world, and he's very respected. And so the one question you want to ask yourself right now, and or your clients or their CPAs that are skeptical, is if it's good enough for David Young and his legal team, is it good enough for you and your client's legal team? And so that's what's helped me get confidence in this, because as a real estate broker myself, I'm not a tax professional. I'm an expert in the deferred sales trust. But even 10 years ago when I was learning about this, it took me time to really get confident about it. But it wasn't until I had a lot of these amazing professionals who have excellent track records look at it, see it, and this includes CPAs, attorneys, and they say yes to it, okay? And that's really important. By the way, you can hear David's full story at capitalgainstaxsolutions.com. The second one is a gentleman named Cal Garvin, and Cal was an actual deferred sales trust client, and he decided to use the deferred sales trust for his own business, and he kind of had an ace in his pocket. The ace in his pocket was his wife, and his wife happened to work for the Secretary of State. She was a treasury attorney on that side, and she was like a G5 attorney, which is really, really high up there in the government. And so he brought it home one day to her. He said, "Hey, look, honey, I told you I'd never do anything that I didn't feel that you said yes to. There's this deferred sales trust thing. I don't know if it's legal or not, but if it is legal, we can retire 10 to 15 years earlier." You see, he had a certain number he had to hit in order to pay after tax, right? After tax. But now, if he used the deferred sales trust, he could sell today, in which he could save from having to grow his business at that new number, okay? So he goes, "Well, if I can do this, we can retire 10 to 15 years earlier. Check it out. If you say no, no worries, I'll keep working. But if you say yes, we can have a transformational exit plan." What did that mean for him? Well, A, he can retire from this business for 35 years. B, he can move closer to his kids and family in a different state. And C, he could now tell his story for more people to help them out. And so he went from too good to be true, not sure it's legal, to 100% all in. And that is Cal's story. And again, he said, "Hey, after 35 years in the financial service business and considered an expert, I thought I knew everything, but I learned something new." And that's, again, what we want to teach you. So once you understand these things and you look at the track record, thousands of closes, billions under management, they also provide audit defense, or the tax attorneys do for the deferred sales trust. It really becomes easy and simple. And so what are the steps? Well, step one is to map out a wealth plan with myself, with Jake, with any of your trusted advisors to try to find out where and how the funds could potentially be invested based upon your risk tolerance. Step two is to sell the assets. So whether it's investment property, whether it's cryptocurrency. Now, there's a couple extra steps within the cryptocurrency world and where we have to set up the trust account inside of the exchange and from there make the transfer, but then from there go into the trust. But that's essentially the second step. Step three is to fund the trust and then invest the funds. By the way, the funds are held at some of the largest banks in the world, such as TD Ameritrade, Charles Schwab. They never move without your signature. Everything is secure, 24/7 access of you online. But really, step four is to be able to enjoy your wealth. We're on our mission to deliver transformational exit planning for yourself and for your clients, and to be able to take the funds and invest how and when you like at any time. Okay, but as an overview, what again exactly is the deferred sales trust? Well, let's just say it's $1 million, okay, that they would have paid $400,000 of tax. Instead of taking all of that million, they are deferring that, and they are carrying back a promissory note in the amount of typically 8% on that $1 million of what it's earning over a 10-year period, and then they can renew for as long as they want. They can also cash out whenever they want and just pay tax on that. So we're going to walk through how this works, and then Jake, are you ready to jump in and start asking some good questions here as well?
Absolutely.
All right.
I'm ready as soon as you are.
Yep. So we're going to take a live case, actually, that Jake and I are working right now. We're going to leave the client's name out of it, but it's about a $10 million cryptocurrency case. And I believe the basis, Jake, what would you say the basis? Do we have the approximate what the basis is?
The basis is only around a little bit above $1 million.
Okay, so we're just gonna use $1 million as the simplicity here, okay? And we're gonna use a rough number. What do you think, Jake? 30% or 40%? What do you think the tax might be if he does nothing?
The actual tax rate would be exactly 42.95%, including state and federal.
Okay, so we're just gonna use just 42 to be simple here, and we're just gonna say, 10 minus 1 is 9 million. So if we take 9 million by 42%. Okay, 9 million by 42%. They're looking at about $3.78 million of tax. Okay, so if they do nothing, if they just sell cash out tomorrow, that is the tax bill. So we're trying to solve for this 3.78. You see that, Jake?
Yep.
Okay. So instead of just again selling the cryptocurrency directly to a cash buyer, right? Someone who has the 10 million and incurring this 3.78. We're just going to add an additional step, okay? And this is important to understand. What we're doing here is we're deferring the tax. We're not avoiding, we're deferring. Kind of like an IRA, kind of like a 401k, if you think about it. If you receive income, but if you put some of that income or some of that wealth into an IRA or 401k, the government allows you to defer tax and let that grow. So think of this like the DST IRA or a DST 401k. It's kind of a nice way to think about it. Instead of taking all that money up front, this $10 million can be put into the trust. And so we set up a trust account at an exchange, okay? And guess what? It's going to transfer. It's a simple way to put it. Transfer to this new exchange. Now, every exchange is a little bit different, right? And one might require an LLC first to do that. And we might need to go to a few, we have to, depending on their procedures and depending on their processes, we might have to do this a little bit different. But the simple answer is it's going to transfer the trust, the $10 million, in exchange for a promissory note. And again, what's a promissory note? Well, you're just becoming the lender. You're becoming the bank. And you're going to receive a zero down payment. Now, can you receive some cash and pay some tax? You absolutely can. But if you wanted to make it a zero tax transaction or close to a zero tax transaction, you would take a zero down payment in exchange for what's called a promissory note. Think of yourself like if you have a loan on a house and the house says, hey, we'll loan you money on the house. You put 10% down, 20% down, and we'll loan you that. Well, guess what the bank has? They have a promissory note for the difference. So in this scenario, your promissory note would be for the full $10
million. So Brett, as a question.
Yeah.
You know, I've got this client with a few personal desires with some of the funds, some of the uses of the funds. Mm-hmm. Should he roll everything through the trust first and then take out what he wants personally, or should he roll only what he's going to keep in the trust for the immediate future?
Yeah, it just depends on the timing of when he wants those funds. And so we probably wouldn't, on this scenario, we're not going to do all $10 million in one transaction. In fact, we're probably going to start with, you know, say $10,000, just we call it get the pipes flowing, right, with the funds. I mean, everything is going to be set up and verified and checked. And so if we'll start with the first $10,000, then he might slowly dollar cost average up into this $10 million bucks, right, slowly get there. And so if for some reason he wants to cash out of his own and pay the tax on that, he probably would just do that directly from the trust, if that makes sense. But if it's not something he needs right away and he wants to just sit on the sidelines, then we'd go to the trust first and then move out. Does that answer the question, Jake?
It does. And just in addition to that question, the client is very charitably inclined, wants to start a foundation with a certain amount of these funds. That's obviously very much a tax-favored thing. How have you handled investors' desires like that in the past?
Yeah, so you can do a CRT, which is a charitable remainder trust, which is one option, depending on how charitable you are. However, we always say compare that against the DST because we're a lot like the charitable, except no charitable is required. So the no C part of the charitable is required for the DST. So we would work on a specific basis, and it might be a mixture of both, by the way. He might do $2 million into the charitable remainder trust and $8 million to the deferred sales trust. But the reason we would push back on that a little bit is you could say, well, do you want more flexibility to change that? Because a charitable is typically irrevocable when it is irrevocable once you pass away. And so there's some restrictions there. We like to keep the freedom with the family and be able to just take distributions and then pay a charity if they want to. But that is kind of another, it just depends on the client, but we can certainly help you with that as well. So let me go back to this real fast to make sure.
My biggest takeaway from that answer is it's very flexible and it can work hand in hand with philanthropic endeavors.
Exactly. Absolutely can. So back to the trust part and how this all works. So $10 million goes into the new exchange account of the trust name. And by the way, it's a brand new EIN. It only does business with you, the individual, right? It doesn't commingle. All that stuff is all safe. We use a big bank. It's a $16 billion bank. They provide what's called deposit account control agreement. But when it transfers to $10 million, well, the trust turns around and sells it for $10 million. So it establishes a brand new basis, okay? Brand new basis. So it bought and sold for $10 million, right? So if you buy and sell something for the same price, guess what? There's no tax. And this cash buyer, they fund the trust and the $10 million goes into the trust. And so when the smoke clears, they have the coin, they're gone, and you're left with a promissory note for $10 million, of which you say, well, what is this secured against? Where can I invest the funds? And this is where really what I think the transformation comes in here. So let's just say, Jake, for your particular client, where might he buy an apartment complex? Let's just say that. Where do you think he might buy one?
Let's say that he would buy in southern Utah.
Okay.
He would buy a lakefront. Let's call it a
little lake right here.
Let's call it a bed and breakfast operation.
Yeah, this is my little tree here. Okay, cool. So we've got a lakefront property, and we got a little bed and breakfast in there. And let's just say this property is, let's just make it simple, $5 million. I'll say it's a nice deal. It's $5 million. Okay. How do we take this $10 million and put it into five? Well, it's actually really simple. We're gonna form an LLC right here. You guys ever see that guy named Bob Ross? Where he's like, we're just gonna make this little tree over here, right? We're gonna make this little LLC over here, and we're gonna put $5 million into this LLC of the trust, and we're actually gonna do a partnership with the client. Okay, it's not unlike anything else that maybe Jake and I were doing. Jake and I wanted to go on a partnership and buy this $5 million property in southern Utah. We could do that. Jake could form an LLC, and Jake could do all the work. I'm in California. Jake is in Utah. And guess what? I could put up all the money, and we could collectively go buy this property. Jake doing the sweat equity, doing the management, doing the work, and the me being the silent investor. So in this scenario, the trust can become a silent partner with you in this LLC to go buy this property. Okay, you can buy it all cash. You can put a loan on it. But now this property, let's just say it's producing, I don't know, $150,000 a year. Maybe that's a little low. Let's say $250,000 a year. Okay, in cash flow. So this cash flow, and Jacob, if you don't mind sharing, but your particular client, how much income is he making per year on an annual basis right now?
Right now, it's actually very, very humble earnings of around $125,000.
So immediately, and by the way, he could hire a property management to do this too. It doesn't have to be him managing it all. He could walk away and never work again. Is that a fair summary, Jake?
Correct.
If he wanted to, right? So we're going to replace the income. And that's just on the first $5 million. The other $5 million could go into stocks, bonds, mutual funds, an allocation in which Jake would present based upon a risk tolerance questionnaire. By the way, we're not guessing on this. We are, everything is mathematical, and it could be stocks, it could be bonds, it could be mutual funds, it could be insurance, stuff that's foundational to building wealth. What are some of the restrictions? Well, we got to keep at least 20% liquid, 20% liquid. So of this $10 million, $2 million has got to stay in stocks, bonds, mutual funds, investment grade securities. The other $8 million can go back into investment real estate, go back into a business, ground up development. I have a client in Alabama who sold a $2.6 million business, and he's able to defer $600,000 of tax. And then he's building 70 units in Tennessee, all tax deferred. So we covered a lot today. I'm going to pause it right there because we're over our goal is to do 30 minutes of a presentation and then 30 minutes of like questions and breakout. So that being said, we have a couple questions so far. Is there a team that evaluates 1031 versus deferred sales trust versus Delaware statutory trust? Yeah, that's exactly what we do for that question. That's a great question. Our company is called Capital Gains Tax Solutions. And so what we do is we want to give you the best, the 1031 exchange, the Delaware Opportunity Zone, deferred sales trust, charitable remainder trust, and literally just say, hey, here are the options. Here are the pros and cons. Do we typically find that the deferred sales trust is the best? Yeah, typically we do, because why? Right now you have values of real estate that are so high, right? Remember, we want to sell high and buy low. We don't want to sell high and buy higher 180 days later. And I have a whole series on that. If you look on YouTube, go to Capital Gains Tax Solutions. I have a free video series on the 1031 exchange versus the Delaware. For those who are wondering what the Delaware statutory trust is, that's just another form of a 1031 exchange. And I call that the blockbuster Hollywood video way of doing things, right? You have very, very short time frame to identify, 180 days to close. But remember, the 1031 exchange only works for investment property. Does not work for cryptocurrency. Does not work for a primary home. does not work for artwork or collectibles, doesn't work for a business, right? So it's Blockbuster, it's very restrictive, whereas the deferred sales trust works for cryptocurrency, works for public-private stock, works for primary homes, investment, real estate. Second part about the Delaware statutory trust is that you give up all control, right? So it completely goes to a third party, typically, unless you're doing your own Delaware, which a lot of folks aren't. And it's 10 years, 7 to 10 years, illiquid. Most of the time, these properties are not value add, meaning there's not a lot of huge upside. They also have gigantic fees. I've heard as much as sometimes only about 85 cents on every dollar is actually going into the real estate, and the other 15%, every other 15 cents is going towards fees. So you want to just be aware of that. Now, that being said, we still help clients who are doing Delaware statutory trust. In fact, we just closed a deal 2 weeks ago. They did a partial Delaware. It was about $1.4 million deal out of Colorado. She wanted to do a partial Delaware and then a partial deferred sales trust. So it's not always just one size fits all. It just depends on what your needs are and what your desires are. So that is a great first question there. Do you have a certain time frame to invest the DST with a certain amount of time? So the trust can go for 10 years, and every 10 years you can renew for 10 years and renew, renew, renew. And then you can go back and pass it to your kids inside of a living trust, and they can keep going on this. As far as when you invest the funds, no, there's no like you have to invest it right away. You can certainly delay and do some dollar cost averaging, which is what a lot of our clients do. Like, for example, during COVID, we had a lot of folks that were very cautious. I had clients, like we did a deal in Walnut Creek. It was about $1.5 million deal. And they sat in the bank for 9 months, did nothing. So you have to approve when the funds are invested, how they're invested. You have to sign for that. So that is that. And then the next one is, how is it different from a monetized installment sale? Great question. So a monetized installment sale is also based on 453. They say, hey, we'll give you 93.5% of the funds up front. We have found with our tax attorneys that we think that's called constructive receipt. So the foundation of this structure is not taking what's called constructive receipt. Now, the other side, of course, will argue that it's not constructive receipt. But I always point everyone back to seven questions you want to ask of us or any other tax deferral strategy. And the first question is, well, how long have you been doing it? And the deferred sales trust is over 25 years. And who are the tax professionals that are providing the legal defense? And our answer is the DST attorneys that we work with. They're the creators of the structure. How many audits have their actual clients faced? For them, it's been about 14, 15, including 3 formal audits. What was the actual outcome of those audits? For us, it's perfect, 100% perfect, no issues, all successful, no change IRS audits. The next most important question is, do they provide audit defense? Who provides that? How does that look? And also, are there any pending litigation? So I believe right now there's still some pending litigation going on with the monetized, so you just want to be very cautious about that and be aware of that. But yeah, we definitely would say compete in one sense, but and we think that you want to be very cautious that you're standing on thin ice with that structure. But I'm not a legal mind for that, and you definitely want to you're welcome to take a peek at that with them. So next question, does this work? Oh, by the way, the monetized two goes for 30 years typically, and then you're done. Ours can go for 60, 90 years. Ours can also move funds outside the taxable estate. I don't believe theirs can do that outside the taxable estate. So there's a number of things there. Does it work in California? When researching, I found that the Franchise Tax Board notice has given some negative guidance. Yes, the Franchise Tax Board about a year and a half ago did issue two 1031 exchange companies a notice that said basically that for installment-like structures, they didn't mention the deferred sales trust, but we are an installment sale. They mentioned that there should be a withholding for exchanges that are failed. So there's some nuance there because, first of all, IRC 453, which is the tax code, is federal law. It's not state law. Second, installment sales have been around for 93 years. So California is opining, the Franchise Tax Board is opining to the exchange companies to make sure they're following procedures for typically what's called withholdings, okay, withholdings. And for all of our deferred sales trust deals out of California, we are providing the withholdings. And so we definitely comply on all those. And we're closing those. I think we closed 6 deals in April alone. And I believe 2 of those were with California exchanges. And so we work with exchange companies out of California to make this work. So 100% works, still works. But yes, there are some folks who opine on certain things, and but it's always worked. We've been through all the audits, and in fact, the biggest audit was actually in California. It was a property in San Diego, $125 million deal, and that was a no change IRS audit.
So,
go ahead,
Brett. Yeah, I was just going to throw out there that my firm has actually done consulting work for an association of accounting firm owners. And even though with that disclaimer up front, I do have CPAs, attorneys, and other people who work for me as we give consulting work, but that doesn't replace you getting your own counsel, correct? But with that being said, the biggest answer is yes, we work with California, we work with clients there. And at the end of the day, one of the most important things that we can take into consideration with a deferred sales trust strategy is that it has been tested on numerous occasions by the IRS. Brett has mentioned, the 14 different times that it has been audited. That's actually a good thing. What you want to look for are the results of those audits. Never once was there findings or requested changes. And what that tells you is that the IRS looked into it deeply, and that should give you a level of confidence that they looked into it deeply and they let it alone. So that's just one of the things that when we help out our clients with strategies in respect to the monetized installment sale, we have clients who do that. But at the same time, it doesn't have 100% track record like the deferred sales trust.
Yep, absolutely. So great, great. And also the deferred sales trust has never been on an IRS watch list, right? So that's the other thing too. So, and then back to the David Young story, right? So David Young, again, 2 years due diligence, right? He's been in the business for 30 years. He worked with like the Warren Buffetts of the financial advising world at PIMCO, right? His entire legal team, he gets approached to stuff all the time. And he's on the inner circle to help manage the funds. Like he would work alongside Jake, alongside me as a supplement for clients who want that. That is very powerful, right? I don't want to overstate that, right? Someone to put their name on something like this, there's a lot of risk, right? There's a lot of risk if it doesn't go well. And so he's there. He's available to talk with all of those things. So, okay, great questions. What else do we have here? Is the DST, are their investments essentially self-directed, or can the trustee deny an investment? So yeah, the trustee can deny an investment based upon the risk tolerance. So just like a financial advisor could deny an investment. So imagine you just pay the tax of $10 million, you paid $4 million, you had six, and you walk into Jake's office and say, hey, Jake, invest these funds. And Jake goes, okay, well, before I invest these funds, I'm gonna have you fill out a risk tolerance questionnaire.
And yeah, ask what the objectives are.
Go ahead, Jake. What's a risk tolerance questionnaire? Would you walk us through that?
Absolutely. So, I mean, if the market were to have a correction of 20%, what would you do? Would you panic and sell? Would you double down like you're in Vegas, so to speak, not necessarily like in Vegas? Would you take advantage of a downward movement? Or would you call your financial advisor? I mean, those are some typical questions. And there's, roughly 11 questions to help identify where somebody's at as far as how we should invest their funds, and then compare that to what the objective is. And if there's multiple objectives, a lot of times we have different buckets or segments, and that's how we appropriately invest suitably. We find suitable investments or sectors for clients to invest in.
Yeah, perfect. And so, Jake, if someone came to you and were like, okay, they filled this risk tolerance questionnaire, and they're say they're pegged at about an 8%, typical return over 10 years, but they say, Jake, I want to put it all into Apple. They're coming out with this amazing new thing called an iPad Super Pro, and all of it in Apple. What would you say?
And I would say, well, that is completely outside of your risk tolerance and what is deemed suitable. Do we need to review those questions again? And oftentimes we would. And normally they would be very similar to how that was to begin with. That is typically educational. We might say, instead of 100% of everything, according to what you're telling me through these questionnaires is 10% is what is suitable.
Perfect. Exactly. So the answer is the same thing here with the deferred sales trust. You, and if you're married, you're going to fill out a risk tolerance questionnaire, and everything is mathematical. There's a score that's determined. In fact, it's the exact same risk tolerance questionnaire that Jake would have you fill out, not counting the deferred sales trust, right? It's the same one. You're going to fill that out. Based upon that, you'll get a score. Based upon that score, you'll get a rate of interest, typically 8%. Sometimes it can be 7 or 6 or 5 if you're ultra conservative. And based upon that, that becomes the constitution for how and where the funds are invested. So what does that look like now? Well, you say, I want to do some real estate, or I want to start a business, or I want to I like this Apple stock. Can we put some of it into Apple stock? The answer is yes, yes, yes. All of those are yes. Now, in proportion and as it reflects the risk tolerance questionnaire. So there is an ability for me as a trustee to say no because it's too risky for the trust. You see, as the trustee, and by the way, we are the owner of the trust. Remember, you're the lender. This is important because if you had sold it to yourself, it'd be taxable. But since you're lending the funds to the trust in conjunction as a trustee, you have to sign, I have to sign. And so self-directed would be the inappropriate word here, but suggested deals. And I'll give you an example of a few of these now. So we have a client that sold a $20 million.
And I think if I might just add, Brett, that the definition of the individual's new role, the beneficial owner or the beneficial lien holder, you know, the beneficiary, the trustee is acting on behalf of the trust and the trust interest and the beneficiary's trust and trust interests. So with that being said, you're acting on behalf, but you are the trustee. And when if the IRS were ever to come and scrutinize anyone, they're not scrutinizing the beneficiary. They're scrutinizing the trustee. They're looking at you, Brett, not at the client.
Yeah. And also clarify too. So technically you're not the beneficiary of the trust. You are the lender, right, who's owed the money. Now, we do have a trust that moves funds outside the taxable estate where then your children can be the beneficiary. But there's some nuance there. And those are typically for larger deals above $10 million to help with some estate tax challenges. So, but the key is everything has to be approved and signed by you. And we've done deals where clients are buying apartment complexes, building apartment complexes, right? We got to keep 80% can go illiquid. 20% liquid. Okay. So we got to keep some ratios. So we're tax planners and tax optimizers, and we don't want you to step on a landmine. We're going to be working with your CPA. He's going to be doing your personal tax returns. We're going to be working through this with the DST tax attorneys. We're all a team here, right? We're not here to say no, but we're here to help you to not step on a landmine. And as we do that together, this transformation happens. So hopefully that answers the questions, but we got to stay within the guardrails of the IRS. Okay. So what other questions do we have here right now? What do you
mind if I touch on Craig's questions here? He's got a few of them.
Yeah.
So there's the mechanics of it. And then Brett, you can touch on the actual legal side of it if you'd like. But the mechanics of moving. So Craig says, so basically moving crypto to a DST is essentially cashing out and deferring tax with a question mark, right? Mm-hmm. The mechanics of it is more of a transfer in kind. In the investment world with stocks and bonds, a lot of times when you open up a new portfolio and you just move maybe from one custodian to another, et cetera, you're not cashing anything out at that point. Though at some futuristic moment, you may want to liquidate some of your coins. And so essentially we're moving assets in the most tax efficient way, which oftentimes is like a transfer in kind, into an ownership type scenario under the trust. And then we can deploy those actions of liquidation or whatever in the timely fashion of your choice, which of course, a lot of clients, like an individual we spoke with earlier today, he already has orders placed for when money or the coins hit certain dollar amounts that they'll automatically cash out. And so we don't want to change any of that. Or there's those investors that want to stay up till 3 a.m. and then make a change, what have you, right? We don't want to derail any of those endeavors so that you maximize what the value is of those coins. But we want to be able to provide it so that it happens under the name of the trust so that we can show the IRS, yes, there were these transactions. However, it happened in the name of the trust. And because of that, it's all deferred. And then Brett, would you like to add anything to that?
No, that's exactly right. That's spot on. I'll go to the next question here. What do you mean a trust account and an exchange mean? So it's just regarding crypto. So let's just say it's Coinbase Pro, Binance, Gate.io. We're going to literally get an new EIN for the trust, and it's going to be a brand new entity. Let's call it Marin 2021 DST. And then that trust is going to open an account at, let's say, Coinbase. Okay. And that's a new account at that exchange. So that's what we mean by that. Hopefully that answers the question, right? How is the trustee determined? So the trustee, there's just a few of us. There's just a few trustees. Trustees determined, we work with a group called the Estate Planning Team, and the Estate Planning Team is the co-founder of the Deferred Sales Trust, along with the law firm who founded this. And so there's three parties. So we are, let's just say, trained expert certified, if you will, on this deferred sales trust over a period of years. The 10,000 hour rule is what I say. You want to make sure whenever you're doing something with somebody, whether it be selling your house, financial advisor, deferred sales trust trustee, they have the 10,000 hours and the expertise on this, because it does take a team of professionals to execute this. So so if you work with us, I would be the exclusive trustee. That's how the trustee is determined. Also to note, you can't choose your own trustee. So in the past, there's certain structures, and the reason they have failed, the most common reason they failed that are similar to this, is that the trustee truly wasn't third party. Okay. Meaning they were like a cousin, a friend, a college roommate, someone who worked for the individual, where they essentially, the IRS deemed that you had too much control, or what's called unilateral control. And I think there was a case in kind where the trustee was just signing off on every single order, just not looking at the due diligence, not looking at the information, and not considering the entire deal. And on that scenario, that's deemed taxable. Okay, so it's very important to have third party unrelated, and that's what we provide here at Capital Gains Tax Solutions. So we have a few more in the chat here. And by the way, we're going to be doing this every Friday at 10 a.m. Invite your CPA. Invite whoever you like to come on here.
As a last question, I think Janice has a good question. Do you see that?
Oh, go ahead. What's the question?
Surviving multiple audits is a plus, she says. And risk tolerance questionnaire is helpful. Do the funds transfer at close of escrow, so the money is never touched?
Correct. Just like a 1031 exchange. So the funds are transferred to the trust, or if it's in the exchange account, from that personal account to the new account, right? And therefore, it's not personally taken to your personal bank account. That's really important. Just like a 1031, from exchange to accommodator, from here we're going to the trust account. Therefore, it's in a deferral state. So that's exactly right. We have a question here. It says, I hold approximately $1 million in crypto, which I store in cold storage wallets. What is the minimum money amount required to move crypto to a DST? So typically, we like to see at least $1 million net proceeds and at least $1 million of gain. Now, you might start out with $100,000 or $10,000 just to, again, get the things moving and dollar cost out of this. But what we don't want is someone who has $300,000 and about $50,000 of liability and knowing that they're not going to have even the potential to get to that million. Okay. So now, will we do a deal at $700,000 or $800,000 or $900,000? Sure. Right. But our minimum we've found is at least $1 million. Now, you might take two transactions. You might say, well, Brett, I'm selling my primary home. I'm selling some crypto and they're both $500,000 or so. Can I combine them into one trust? And the answer is yes, you can do that as well. So reach out to us and we'll work with you. But we just generally want to make sure there's actually a viable plan or even options to get to that $1 million. The next one says, do you guys 1031 then convert into a DSTs? If so, how does that work? So we can do the deferred sales trust at two prime points, okay, for investment properties. The first one is at the close of escrow. The second one is at day 45 in exchange, or day 181. And now it depends upon what's been identified and what's where, but that's only for investment property. For every other asset class, by the way, does not qualify for 1031 exchanges. They have no option there. We need to set up the trust prior to transfer, okay? So basically moving crypto to DST is essentially cashing out and deferring the tax. Yeah, you're not cashing out, you're deferring it. How long can I defer it? As long as you want. You can pass it to your kids. Are there any additional tax incentives for agricultural owners selling AG assets and moving into this? Yeah, potentially if you have an estate tax issue, right? And or you want to reset a brand new depreciation schedule, which is also important to understand. Would your crypto that is moved to the DST be required to be moved to a different asset class, real estate, stocks? Yeah, I mean, it's required in the sense that we need to make a return on the money. The question is how and where are the funds invested? Well, the goal is to, let's say it's $1 million in there to make 8%. So in that sense, yes, because if it just sits in the bank, inflation is going to eat that up, which kind of defeats the purpose. Now, does it mean you have to do it right away? No. Again, we can dollar cost average and delay on that. Just so I make sure I read correctly, when a business is sold, those proceeds are not 1031 eligible. Correct. Is there a minimum to invest in DSTs? We said that $1 million. Can the client put the capital gain amount in the crypto or stock or tax deferred exchange? Can the client put the capital gain? Oh, okay. You're asking if they can just keep the basis and just put the gain in there. The answer is if you want 100% tax deferral, The answer is no. If you want to take cash, take your money. It's your money. You'll pay tax on that difference of amount. Okay.
Yeah.
Surviving multiple audits is a plus. Okay. We talked about that. Okay. So I think we're out of time and I think we've answered the questions. And sorry we couldn't do breakout rooms. Maybe next week we'll do 2 hours, okay, so people can get to know each other. But I'm going to also do a call for action. You can go to capitalgainstaxsolutions.com. I'm going to put that into the chat right now where you can go and, again, you can schedule a time. We also have tons of resources. We have a free ebook. Make sure you mention this particular webinar. Okay. And then we can set up a time for Jake, myself, and you to go through your particular scenario. And then if you're a real estate professional, you can go to experttaxsecrets.com and you can get even more coaching, more hands-on, to help your clients defer the tax and invest into real estate. And you get an additional buy-side commission. Jake, any last thoughts before we let everybody go?
No, I just want everyone to know that the purpose of all of this not only is for us to share what some of the best strategies are for individuals making a lot of money through crypto, but it's also so that the crypto millionaires in this group can network amongst each other, that you can make friends, have associations, and that obviously moving forward, you can take advantage of the very latest and greatest nuances, how the IRS is treating crypto coins from the standpoint of, yes, it's not a stock, but it's an asset and all these other things. And they're coming out with software to track transactions. Let's help people through a legal and an appropriate method make the most tax advantaged decisions going forward and let you mingle amongst others in your same situation. That way you can have a level of confidence moving forward, knowing that what you're doing is a solid strategy.
Yeah, so next week we're going to go 2 hours. Just so you know, we're also having a special guest. He's a client of mine. His name is David, and he sold a $20 million piece of property in Las Vegas. And then he sold a second one in Phoenix for $16.6 million. He's a general partner, and he's going to share his deferred sales trust story. So you're going to get live from our cryptocurrency mastermind his entire story, right? And he's also an attorney, very smart. And so look for that one next week. We're going to go 10 a.m. PST to noon PST. We're going to send out a link to register for that, invite your friends, family. And then a part of that too, we're going to do breakouts. Okay. So the real estate professional world, crypto world, financial advising world, tax world, we're all going to try to work together on this. Like Jake said. Okay. So that being said, again, go to capitalgainstaxsolutions.com, go to experttaxsecrets.com, and we'll see everybody next week. Thanks everybody.
Have a great weekend. Happy Labor Day.
Bye-bye.